Hello there. GM Lurch Lurchington here with another episode of Star Wars Showdown on Iceball Station. With me again tonight are our players and their characters. Narset Jin, played by the Bendu.
Blows and blessings.
Warum, played by Dan.
Hey, everybody.
Zavik, played by David.
Good to see you again.
And Zeef, played by our host, Kyle.
Hello there.
Players, if you're ready to roll Destiny, let's see if the Force is with us tonight. The internet is being slow. Oh, okay. One light and three darks are the Destiny this session, fellows. It looks like the Force is with me to begin.
It's like last time.
Yep. Our heroes had split off from each other, and the party had split along the lines it had already formed. And you'd gone off on your separate investigations. Master Silver Star and Knight Jin plan to go on a tour of the Volcano Factory refinery with Rathamith, the financier of the Expat Club. However, his reticence to readily reveal information, mostly due to his lack of knowledge or general competence outside of the field of finance, frustrated Narset to the point that she figured to give him the heavy hand and get that information out. She did. The Expat Club are concerned about the Imperial problems that have happened here in Fishtown. And after Narset's coat flew open and Rathamith noted her lightsaber, and then a casual remark from the Jedi Knight about, well, I guess we'll just wipe this guy's mind now, right? Terrified the banker. But Master Silverstar was able to come in, play good Jedi, and smooth things over. It was revealed that the Imperial Remnant group that have occupied the Expat Club indeed mostly came as, like, patron. Yeah, they came as customers to watch a racer who had been hired. The club decided to sponsor a racer.
It's off-planet,
as like a,
right?
Yeah, it was like starfighter racing. They were like, well, we will sponsor a racer, and then we can hold races here, and that'll be another business we can do. We already have fishing tours and volcano exploration and gambling and drinking, and we can take you to three other worlds for big game hunting. But now you can also come and bet on races, and we're going to have a starfighter race right here on Iceball. But to hold a race, you have to have a local racer. So they found a racer. They thought it'll bring in his fan base and it'll bring in race fans when we hold races. The racer came and the racer's fans came. And the racer's fans were two shuttles full of Imperial Remnant troops. And suddenly there were 100 former Imperials in the Expat Club, and everyone who wasn't a former Imperial left, except for the 7 people who are the core of the club. And now they're like, shit. And Rathamith is very thankful that you Jedi are here to solve the problem for him. And he's also terrified of you, Narset. And he's absolutely going to squeal about the fact that you are a Jedi to the rest of the club, because you rolled like 5 threats or some shit and a despair maybe when you did your coercion. So he definitely saw you were a Jedi and is definitely telling his friends that juicy tidbit of the hottest gossip on Iceball since the Remnant showed up. Jedi. You know? Oh my god, guys, I've saved the day. It turns out the strangers were Jedi and they said they would help us because I asked them to. Thank me. You know?
Yeah, buy me a drink. Yeah.
While all this was going down, Zeef, by the time you made it back to Fishtown after the shakeup on the docks last night, Junior already knew that a shootout had gone down at the docks and told you to call Spider. And instead you tied like 4 more on and didn't call Spider. And then the next day, when you pulled up to the gondola platform that heads to the landing bays where your friend's ship is, some of Spider's guys were there. Well, they're all Vork's guys, but Vork's not here. So as far as everybody is concerned, they're Spider's guys. So Spider's guys were there saying,
hey, weren't you going to call the boss? Didn't you get the message that he wanted to talk to you?
Well, you said, of course, I'm going to talk to him right now. And you did. You guys went back to the docks to the exact same warehouse where cartel boys were already tossing the joint. And you searched the place a little bit, and then you talked to Spider. Spider's a businessman. He understands that his boss thinks it's kind of cute that you're doing this whole white knight private detective thing in Fishtown. And the same way that they let Fishtown do their thing, they're letting you do your thing because you haven't stepped on the cartel's toes because you're not that stupid. Any crimes that are done by the cartel are, by definition, not crimes and therefore don't need to be investigated. It's solved. The cartel did it. He must have deserved it. If you have any problems with that, you can come talk to Spider. So, Spider, of course, extended the job offer once again.
Zeef, you seem pretty good at this stupid little game you're playing in Fishtown. If you actually want to make some real money doing a real job instead of playing make-believe in Fishtown, come work for the cartel.
You said what you always do, which is a less polite form of no thank you. But for whatever reason, you did still give up all the information you had about the goings-on the night before to Spider. Well, not all of it. You let him know about the operation you found in the warehouse. You let him know that it was off-world. You let him know that there was a conversation with the boss upstairs. You didn't let him know about anything that you got out of your little torture session in the, I'm sorry, it was an interrogation. It just ended with death. With your interrogation in the land speeder. So you didn't reveal that, but you pretty much gave up everything you knew because you thought there would be a quid pro quo. And then Spider just said,
yeah, that's great. Like I said, come down to the club. We'll get comfortable and we'll talk.
Then you gave up everything that you had. And then he said,
okay, that's great. Thanks for all of that. Come on down to the club and we'll talk.
And they've left. With you and Warm now standing in this warehouse, there's a couple of Weequay from the cartel are still standing around. They're guarding the area. They've already plundered it themselves. They're chuckling mildly as you stand there, realizing that anything you were going to get out of Spider for the information that you had, you were going to get out of him at the club. What's he going to give you here in this empty warehouse? And now you've already given him everything. By the time you get to the club, you got nothing.
I mean, I got everything I need out of Spider by getting Spider off my back.
From Mo, Larry, and Curly. Absolutely. He's still expecting to see you at the club, but you're the kind of guy who doesn't take their invitations, no matter how many times they make them. So we're going to begin with the camera on Zeef and Warm standing near the front of this warehouse where the drug operation was set up on the dock. Other than the chuckling Weequay and the wind blowing in off the bay straight along the dock and into the open doors of the warehouse, there's no comment for you. You are completely the masters of your own destiny in this moment.
What do you think, Warm?
So I think Warm would turn to Zeef and be like, so this is where it all went down the other day, huh?
Yeah, right in here. Drugs, secret transmissions, all kinds of interesting things the other night.
You got any computer systems around?
I did notice an empty terminal in the office upstairs, next to the holo transmitter. I told Spider to get some slicers down here, see if he could trace the call. Not sure they're going to share that information with us, though, so have at it.
Maybe I'll take a look on my own, then. And Worm's going to go up to the office where I think they pushed the guy out the window, probably.
That is indeed the office where the holo transmitter was. Yes, right at the top of the stairs. You see, it's cold in here because the window is broken out. And you recognize some fabric from Zeef's jacket stuck in some of the shards. And there is a holonet uplink built into the desk-mounted terminal of sort of the computer desk unit that serves as the desk in this office.
So I'm going to, I guess, plug my datapad into the terminal and, I don't know, see if I can get any information about the operations they have running here.
It is going to be only an average computer's check to get in, but there are two black die worth of security to access the system.
You can't just, like, cram your robot on?
And a black die from the cold, because the window is open, and it is freezing this room.
I'm gonna call, Stomp. Did we bring Stomp with us? I forget. No, we didn't, I don't think.
No, I think he's back at the... Yeah, he's back at the agency, because we dropped them off on our way here.
Yeah. All right. So I'll just have to do it myself.
Am I able to give Worm a boost in any way?
If you went up and helped him,
okay. Yes,
but that would preclude you from doing more investigation downstairs.
Sure.
At the same
okay.
time.
All right. Then I won't.
Because you searched around the tables, but you haven't like searched the warehouse generally. You know, like the back and over there in the corners and stuff. You know what right. I mean? You just searched like where these tables were, where these guys were cutting spice into the drugs they were selling. It wasn't that the guy OD'd on unrefined spice. It was that it was way too strong of a cut, basically. You know, like, there's way too much glitter yell in their glitter stick kind of thing.
Right.
You know, like, they need to cut it more and make it less of a hit. But it's not. It's high, they're selling high-octane Narshadot drugs.
Right. These guys, these locals are used to the gunjack-level stuff, so this
Ooh,
is just
triumph.
Killing them.
Oh.
Nice.
Yeah, baby. What do we got?
Oh, yeah.
Triumph.
Triumphant success with an advantage.
Advantage.
So you unlock it. You see that triumphantly there is a recording of the hollow communication class.
Nice.
Okay.
Because otherwise there wouldn't have been a you know what I mean? This guy's not like backing up a call where the boss chewed him out so that he can watch another hologram of a scary shark later. Like, they don't okay. they don't want to think about the boss when they don't have to think about
mm-hmm.
Can part of that triumph be like that there was some like metadata associated with the call, like
yes of course yeah yeah I mean
there,
I mean that
there's like the address that the call was coming from, or like the, you know, what planet sure. it was originating on, something like that.
It's IP or whatever.
Getting into the system and the success and advantage will get you that stuff. The advantage is getting you the metadata of the call, because okay. even though from a like gameplay perspective that's more valuable that you have the metadata, like you actually have the call too, so that okay. you can like watch it and, you know, like get that. So that's the triumph, because that's them saving the metadata of a past call makes sense for it to be there, and for an advantage it's there because they didn't clear it out. Triumphantly, for whatever reason, like a hollow of the call is there and you can watch, you know, the incoming side of the conversation
okay.
last night,
yeah.
which normally wouldn't be on here, but triumphantly yeah. it is. You know what
so
I mean?
So we can see,
and
like,
advantageously, you have the metadata of that call as well.
So can we see, like, the room in the hollow that the Karkaroo brothers are calling from? Like,
I mean, it's
is it
kind of
just like
so
objects floating
say,
in the foreground style? That's how usually holograms work.
So it's
like furniture.
It's a triumph.
You might see some furniture.
I'm going to say yeah. you're going to have to make, like, a perception check whilst watching it to try to do that, because Darth Maul was able to notice Ahsoka
okay.
Tano from, like, 30 meters away on a giant catwalk down to a much lower catwalk while he's right. having a conversation with a pike, and he's like, who's that 50 feet away over there? Not
okay.
where the holo projector's pointing at all.
If you motion over to me like, hey,
so
Zeke, I found something, I might be able to help you there too, because I do have an investigation now.
I was
exactly.
going to say, yeah, so
he
warm,
gets this and you search it later.
Is
investigative. Damn, okay.
So, I was going to say, so Worm is looking at, you know, he's scrolling through all the data that he just got on his data pad, and he calls Zeef, who was helping him with making sure the connection was good before when he was making the check, and he calls him over. He says, Zeef, I think I got something here.
What
and,
you say, got?
I play back the recording on the holo projector for him to see.
Okay, so.
And then if he wants to do like a perception check on that, see if he recognizes anything or anybody in the scene, maybe.
The metadata shows, yeah, it's from Narshada. That's obvious from the first part of the holonet encoding. You have looked at enough holonet
sure.
transmission codes in past investigation to know the area codes, you know, for like holonet calls to Narshada. Always have. This is their first data block for, you know, the routing and stuff. More than that will require more investigation, but, you know, it's a call from Narshada, which definitely tracks, and the holo call, when it comes on, it is from waist up. It is still 5 feet of person in a full life-size hologram. Just from the waist up, this individual's 5 feet tall, massive, shark-headed, huge rows of sharp teeth, broad-shouldered, easily 3-4 feet across the shoulders, massive arms, with just a tight white tank top and some chains. This is the much more reasonable Dinsdale Carcara. This is the guy who just nails your head to a table.
But not putting the pencil there.
Oh, no, I mean, like, he uses an industrial-sized rivet gun and physically will nail your head to a table. But, like, it's because you deserved it and you did something wrong.
His brother, Doug.
Yeah, it's... I deserved it, you know? If I hadn't done the thing I did, I wouldn't have gotten my head nailed to the table. And, you know, I'm glad that Dinsdale was there to nail my head to the table so that I learned not to do those kinds of things. It's a very reasonable gentleman. Nail your head to a table, but only if you did something that, you know, he had to. He didn't want to. He had to. He had to. With what I did, he had to nail my head to that table. It was the only reasonable course of action.
This is Douglas.
This is Dinsdale.
This is Dinsdale.
Douglas uses word. Douglas will give you a talking to. And Zeef, you heard that grown men would pull their own heads from their shoulders willingly before they would get a talking to from Douglas. But other than that, you never had to suffer a meeting with the elder Carcaro brother. But you've met Dinsdale, and, well, as everyone said, Dinsdale is a reasonable fellow. So he begins by threatening, politely, by way of greeting, to take the Aquilish that he was speaking to's head from his shoulders. This recording does not include the responses from the recipient, for whatever reason, and I'm not going to roleplay the Carcaro brother now, because I did not expect Dan to triumphantly hack the hollow, and I would have had to write this out ahead of time. But,
top man, Dan.
And then he says,
"Oh no, I'm just kidding. Unless, of course, you fucking suck."
He says,
"But you haven't, right? You've been on ice ball for what? Almost a lunar cycle now. You've got to have things cruising by now, right? So how come I'm not hearing about how much money you're making?" "Oh, don't tell me that. I don't want to hear about saturated markets. You've got the best product we can give you. The Carcaro brothers take care of their family. We're not gonna put you out there with shit to compete against the Huts with shit, baby. You've got the best that we can give you. So don't tell me about saturated markets. Tell me about how you're taking away their client. Now tell me what I want to hear." "Okay, that's good, that's good, that's good. I like what I'm hearing. If what you're saying is true, I think we got a nice operation. I think maybe another week or two, maybe me and Dougie come and see how things are going. Don't tell me that. You just told me that you got good batches being turned out. I can't wait to be there. They say the water's nice and cold. We'll go for a swim."
And then more silence. And the message cuts out, at which point you know that the Aquilish in charge of this operation collapsed in his chair, and you burst through the door a couple seconds later and yeeted him out a window.
I did that.
I would not want to go swimming in a cold water with a shark. That just doesn't sound... It's like what you said. It's like, that sounds like, is he being friendly with me, or is that a fucking threat? Like, do I want to go swimming? Do I want to say no to the opportunity of swimming with him? Like... Will he take offense if I say, "No, dog, like, I don't know about swimming with you.
It
doesn't seem like a smart idea. What if I have a cut?"
That's a hell of a situation. So in many ways, I did that guy a favor by killing him. So he didn't have to deal with the social niceties of turning down a swimming invitation from Dinsdale. See, there's a good way to spin it.
Exactly. So you've gotten this hollow message.
Yeah.
And more importantly, you've gotten the metadata from this hollow message that you can investigate at your own terminal back at the shop where you've got software to assist with those kinds of things.
Can I reach out to Stomper with my wrist thing and have him get that process started back at the house?
He would need to get the data.
Well, sure, but I couldn't transmit it to him?
Not at this kind of range.
Okay, no worries.
What? I think it's more like, think Bluetooth or radio, and you're trying to get... This is a lot of data.
I can't airdrop them from one town over. I get you.
Yeah.
No. Not in Star Wars, no. Right. Like, sorry.
Okay, well then we'll just make sure that we download a hard copy and take it with us.
Yeah, it's already on...
Yeah, I got it on my datapad.
Worm's cool. Datapad. Perfect. Yeah. Do you want to investigate the rest of the warehouse?
Yes.
Before you leave?
On our way out, I would like to poke around the rest of the warehouse, nooks and crannies. I will use my perception.
That's not a threat.
All right, so with the threat, you had to see a Karkaro, brother.
I was about to say, I think seeing like a life-size, huge, holographic version of my mortal enemy would probably sober me up that last little bit.
I honestly thought about making y'all make fear checks against a hologram of Dinsdale Karkaro.
He is that fear.
But I was like, and it's a 5-foot-tall, life-size hologram of him from the waist up, like, a foot in front of you, you know? You weren't expecting, you were like, oh, it's gonna be this big. No, it's not! Oh, Dinsdale! Shit! No wonder the guy having a conversation with him was terrified. He doesn't go with the desk-size hologram, he's the boss.
He's getting yelled at by a massive shark.
Everyone he talks to is this big, and he is, yeah, exactly. He's Jawsome. Oh, yeah, that's... if only someone said Street Shark 20 minutes ago, that hologram would have been totally different. Alas. You successfully poke around, even though the specter of Dinsdale Karkaro lurks in the back of your mind the entire time. And you find the real goods. None of Spider's boys thought of this, because the bay is frozen over 3/4 of the year. And the guys who do the fishing go out on skiffs and use vibro saws to cut through a foot of ice. But at the back of this dock, or this warehouse, which is technically on the dock and over the bay, there is a hatch set into the floor plating, which when you pop it open, there's a rush of cold air. And down there below in the darkness, you can hear the sloshing of ice chunks in water. As this warehouse has access down below the frozen surface of the bay. Because it's the Karkaro brothers.
Misa thinking and we got something here.
You know? You have, indeed. Whether you're going to, you know, jump down a tunnel, you know, that might be filled with enemy gangsters right now or not, you know, I won't dictate for you, but you find that. And because it's in the back, and the Weequay are not concerned enough to actually follow you around. You know, Spider just finished talking. You're either going to do what he says or not.
Right.
So,
I think that I'm going to do a very stereotypically Gungan thing and try and have my feet upside down on the top rung of this ladder and like sort of hold myself down, like what Bill Burr did in The Mandalorian.
Upside down.
But I'm gonna Jar Jar it and kind of like not quite controlled. You know what I mean?
I love it. Yeah. So between your athletics and your coordination, I'm going to have you use the worst of those two skills.
I like it.
To make this check. It is going to be a hard check with one setback from the fact that these are slippery frozen rungs, one setback from the fact that it's pitch dark in this tunnel, and one setback from the fact that you're an idiot who's trying to do a cool thing instead of a practical thing by doing it anyway. And
that's my Zeefy.
And you're dumb. And so was Bill Burr, you know? But he succeeded at the check that he made, and it didn't have a bunch of extra setbacks because he wasn't doing it in a dark, frozen tunnel.
And hey,
so it's going to be 3 purples and 3 setbacks for either a coordination or athletics check, whichever one's harder.
Coordination, which is 3 greens.
Do you want to use a destiny point to increase one of those greens to a yellow?
No, I think I can handle this. I'm a Gungan, so like if I fall down, I bounce right back up.
I am going to spend a destiny point
to
upgrade one of the purples into a red.
Okay. And one with
to
force,
see if you do this or if you go for a swim. And if despairingly you like land in the lap of a corn with a spear or not.
And like
you
know, drown. Kind of
you can't drown. That's the one thing that won't happen. You're not going to drown. But you might hit your head, go unconscious, and freeze to death. You know what I mean?
True.
Before you wake up while you're not drowning. 4 successes and 3 threat.
Ooh.
So you successfully hook your feet and drop down a relatively short tunnel so that your head and shoulders are now upside down in the water. And
your
dumb little stalk eyes are just long enough to poke down below the rim. And you see that sort of the area between the pilings that are holding up the docks under the warehouses. There's a lot of material in heavily wrapped and reinforced packaging and crating that has been weighted down and strapped to pallets right there on the bottom of the bay floor. And as you look out further out into the bay, into the murky depths of the water, out under the actual docks projecting out into the bay, as it begins to slope down, you think you see a couple of dim lights out there. But you take three more strain from how freaking cold it is.
Right.
Just to be in there, and you're going to have to make a resilience check when you come back out in a minute, and you're probably going to take some more strain from that. So you're going to take three strain right now from the cold, and after you pull yourself back up, you're going to have to make a resilience check against three purple dice to not take three more strain.
Resilience.
The setback from being wet is being removed. So you did not succeed, but with an advantage, we will reduce one of those, and you take two more strain instead of three more strain. As you sit there shivering now, because everything from here up is soaking, even in your heavy, cold weather coat. It's not it's not that kind of waterproof.
Right.
You know, and it's now wet.
Yeah.
From here up, and it's a cold warehouse, and once you're on the other side of these crates, you're going to be in the wind, blowing right off the bay.
So I'm at seven strain now.
Yeah. Yes, you are.
But I got a whole bunch of clues. Everything is coming up, Milhouse. I'm going to sit my ass down in a crate for a second here and just rest for a moment, catch my breath.
So I want you both to make, I believe it is a discipline or cool check to recover strain. You can recover strain using advantages kind of thing.
Really good.
Five. You get five strain back.
Cool.
There you go. Boom.
Okay, so let's walk out of here like everything's normal. Hop on the speeder, head back to base, grab Stomper, regroup, head back up here after nightfall, grab that evidence.
Sounds good. I want to get Stomper take a look at the data we recovered, too.
Absolutely.
So. All right, so you hop back in and head off. You have spent more than enough time in the city that the Jedi's half-hour trip up the mountain and back down, you're still talking to Spider. By the time that's done. So Narset and Zavin just finished the most awkward alpine gondola ride in the history of awkward alpine gondola rides, with a banker who is vacillating between terror and like pathetic affection, depending on which Jedi is currently at the forefront of his mind. He is delighted with the narrative he has constructed for himself, in which he has successfully recruited you guys to solve all of Expat Club's problems. And he is currently working on his acceptance speech for Club Member of the Year award for having brought upon the triumphant return of the Expat Club, you know, down the line after all the fortune that rolls in, after whatever heroics you guys are going to, those are details. He's not going to worry about them. You know, but that's where he's been. And then his eye will fall upon Narset. He'll shudder. And as soon as the gondola docks in its cradle, he looks ready to run. It's unsure if he's running away from Narset or towards the X-Pack. You know what I mean? But he looks ready to bolt, you know, with either enthusiasm or terror. Once the doors are unsecured, but they haven't been yet, so that you guys can, you know, usurp that. So, what was the ride back down the mountain like for you, Masters Jedi?
You know, I'm gonna try to calm him down. So I would have told him, I know that this is a lot to take in, but we need you to be allies here, and we need you to not spread the word that we are here. Kind of see what he said. Like, how does he take to that?
Without you making a skill check to cause him to agree with that sentiment, his first reaction is to say, he's not going to spread the word, but there's nothing that he doesn't keep from the other members of the board. says, only the board remains, and if we are going to restore the club, it is going to be by working together. There's nothing that I am going to keep from the board. I didn't hide things from them when I caused this problem. I'm not going to keep from them the solution now that it is in my hands. But you have chance to use any of your social skills to change his position on this stance.
We'd absolutely like to.
I was being very communist about this.
He's part of the expat club, man. They got to keep the expat club running. They're the only ones left. If they don't save the club is gone. And it's been around for 250 years, and they're the ones who were responsible when it imploded. They can't let that happen.
You could try to convince him, like, you know, you can tell the others that, like, we'll help you, but just don't tell the others what we are. You can say that, yeah, the off-worlders have agreed to help us, but don't tell the others what we are.
I'd like to make a check before we talk to him too far. I'm going to make a charm check on him and ask that we, instead of him running off to go tell his to tell the club, that we'd like to be there when he does so.
Just a moment. I like it. Diplomatic. He says, well, you're planning to return and continue discussing membership in the club. Then of course you'll be welcome to the discussion.
That sounds fine.
He seems very keen on that idea as well. You know, they were already excited at the prospect of new members. The idea that they might get some Jedi members of the club. Like it has nothing to do with like, oh, they'll save us from the Imperials. It's like, ooh. And then we can also say, during the tenure of Rathamith as financier of the club, two Jedi became members. Club, and that'll be another feather in his cap in like the annals of what happened during the club over the years.
Wait till the newsletter hears about this. Everybody.
In 100 years, when they troll through the archives, they'll see that I blah blah blah. Yeah. So it's like, absolutely, yes. I'd love for you to come back so that we can speak to Kolvar about all this. He's fine for you guys coming along. With him when he speaks to the board. He says, yes, I can give you a lift back with me now if you want. He indicates the street outside at the bottom of the wide steps that lead up to the gondola cradles and says, it appears that you've been abandoned by that Zeef fellow. You really need to pay these natives more if you want them to be reliable. He says, as you can see, the club car is still here. So if you'll be joining me.
It'd be our pleasure.
Right. It's a fairly utilitarian land speeder that has had some aftermarket bodywork put on it to make it look like an older, more classic model of speeder. It's not holding up the best in this environment, but, you know, if they had a full staff and guys in the garage to keep it up, you know, it would probably be a pretty swank ride. And with a Jetson like, you guys head off back into Fishtown. He's taking you directly to the expat club, but in the course of the conversation on the way back to Fishtown, he does ask if you need to stop by your lodgings to pick up anything. He says, of course, if you're joining the club, you'll have accommodations with us and you won't need to stay at a tavern anymore.
I would like to pick up my stuff from the tavern, yes.
He says, and your ward, miss, I know we got off on the wrong foot earlier, and I do apologize for whatever I said that offended you.
Same.
He says, oh, no, nothing at all, nothing at all, whatever. He doesn't seem to know how to acknowledge he turns it into an apology of his own every time instead. He says, no, whatever I had done. That would cause someone with the dedication of a Jedi to lash out as such. Deeply apologize. He says, you've been quiet this entire time, miss. What do you think of our lovely world here? I hope I don't offend, but you certainly suit the aesthetic.
Offhandedly, I was thinking of the local species and their overall feelings of the human I'm curious what the crab people think about the huts and what they think of all these off-worlders and humans doing on their their natural planet. It doesn't seem like their housing environment seems to be all the greatest. And then what was the other thing I was thinking about? What accommodations are at the club? Because the tavern keeper, she's a really nice bird lizard person. Wouldn't want to leave her hanging too much.
He says, well, we definitely want to keep the local economy running as well it could. And as the financier of the club, I can assure you that we have always made sure to have close ties with the entire population of Fishtown. Why, you know, you're now sort of pulling into the city, and he sweeps his arm out as if it is his own domain. He says, why, you know, this entire settlement has reached this level of prosperity in enabling our club and its various services to be provided. They are the ones who make the expat club able to give the level of experience that it does. A true core world experience out here on the rim would not be available without the hard work of all of these beings, native or otherwise. It says, of course, now that the club is in a bit of a downturn, a lot of work isn't needed. But I assure you, once you and your companion here help us return to prosperity, that prosperity will trickle down to the rest of Fishtown.
You said that the Imperial remnant were here because they liked a racer.
He's really, you're gonna have to use a check to get in for, as soon as you're like, oh, the remnant, they're here because he already answered. He's like, I really think that was club business, you understand. You're only prospective members as is. Once you've spoken to Kolvar and you're full members, then you'll be entitled to club dealings. But I really was speaking out of turn at that point. If you want to make a check to get him to dish out.
So meta-wise, he can't tell us who the
He's not gonna tell you any more about that. Lives Nothing club, until you guys can make some check.
So yeah. You're gonna have to rough him up again.
In the back of my head, I'm like, what if we just sabotage his car? What if we just fuck up his spaceship, make him lose every race? If he just loses, will the Empire leave?
I mean, he hasn't even been racing, and they've been like hanging out and getting drunk. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think these guys they've been here for 6 months. They didn't come on a 3-day pass to watch a race. You know what I mean? Like, they were like, oh shit. And they all came here and have moved in. So as long as he's here, they're probably going to stay. And if, like, people start fucking with him, they might turn from, like, a bunch of drunken former Imperials to a bunch of ornery drunken former Imperials. As is.
Our NASCAR.
Right. Yeah, basically, yep. Paradoxically, they're pretty peaceful right now. But if you go and fuck up the number three, don't. Holy shit. No, the locals hate it. And the club is tanked because all of their patronage, other than these guys, left immediately. And these guys aren't spending credits the way that, like, the high rollers who usually came through were spending credits. And that has immediately depressed the entire economy of Fishtown because, like, the dock workers at Fishtown are feeding Fishtown and making money by selling, you know, everybody makes money by selling to the club because they've got the money. And they get everything that they can from Fishtown so that they don't have to actually pay off-world prices for all this stuff. And then they gussy it up and they present it as a core world experience, you know, but they're serving the same protein from the sea that you're eating at Birdie's, just like it's a much smaller portion and it costs 300 credits a plate, you know?
Okay. Well, thanks, friend. Then I am totally open to continue our way down to the casino and become part of your club. I'm interested if your archaeologist friend is there also. She seemed to have a good aura about her.
He looks like he's the kind of person where his first reaction to a statement like that would be a smirk. And then he remembers who he's speaking to again. And at this point, the door to the gondola opens as it docks in the cradle. And he very swiftly exits. And you guys travel via land speeder through Fishtown. It stops at the lower crossroads outside of Birdie's so that Zavix can go in and get his
grab
gear.
His armor. Yeah, his armor. Yep. And your lantern.
He's got a bunch of stuff. Got a bunch of camping stuff because he knew he was going to an icy planet. Narsa, do you accompany him in or not?
Give us a chance to talk.
Yes, sure.
Okay. As you come in, you see that the
place also wanted to go to the gun shop, but it was 6:30 a.m. and they weren't open yet.
He went in anyway, and the guy said he wasn't going to do the work unless Zavix had the money, which he did not.
I thought that was like episode one conversation.
No, that was the
that was the armor shop.
Oh.
Yeah. And right now my Lando thing is on loan to that
guy. At the pawn shop. He pawned. Shop, he went to the pawn shop where he used his greatcoat from Lando as a collateral for the armor, and then he went to the gun shop and asked the proprietor if he could fix the armor, which he said he would not do until he had at least half of the 550 credits that it would cost to do the work. The pawn shop is expecting $3,750 by the end of the week, or they're keeping the code. Okay, so you both go in. By midday, the place is pretty busy because most of these guys don't have paying jobs at the moment. Even if they were fishing, the expats aren't buying. She notices you come in and waves with one of her upper arms as she continues serving drinks to the two gentlemen in front of her at the bar. And once you pass close enough by the bar, either on your way to it or towards the stairs, she remarks that she figured you'd be up at the casino with the rest of the fancy folks for most of the day.
I turn to Birdie and I tell her, well, you might just be right. I plan on heading up to those to seek accommodations up there. Tip her out another 10 credits and grab my stuff. I turn to Narset. Narset, I believe it'd be best if we split up and see what other resources might be available to us. If you wish to come with me, we do that as well.
I'll follow you to the casino. There's a couple of other club members that would be willing for us to like definitely check bases with, and I don't know. There's something about like what he said about the racing that I want to look into, but also it would be best for press kind of like outs us to the crew of being, you know, Jedi, because it's not easy throwing that J word.
So Zavix, were you implying that Narset continue to stay at the tavern?
I think
or
that,
did you just meant split up for the day? Because I couldn't tell.
I knew that she was looking into the plight of the worker, like in the area. You were interested in figuring out the like humanitarian aid side of it, and I didn't know if we just wanted to see what was available, because even though, you know, it sounds really good what that guy has to offer, he seems like shady at the same time. So I feel like it'd be best if we
I want to stick with you and stay present at that whole moment, and then I also want to touch bases with the archaeologist. How many crab people,
which makes
are
sense
we
too.
On are we on slide six, or like how many crab people are there?
There are three Salvex at one of the tables in the corner of the room closest to the refresher.
Then I wish to give 10 credits to Birdie and then pay for a drink for each of the crab people.
Okay, that will be that'll be 30 credits to do that.
So yeah, so I pay Birdie and then buy a round for the local people.
All right. A little social justice witch is at it again. Okay, you guys check out of your accommodation at Birdie's Nest, and with your meager belongings over your shoulders, return to the land speeder, and Rathamuth brings you up the club, up the hill to the expat club. There are a half a dozen young men in black jumpsuits and boots, but no gloves. Appears to be the suit that is worn underneath stormtrooper armor. These are a bunch of armorless, about a half dozen armorless stormtroopers.
All
are
in front of the club.
No, they have brooms and they are sweeping snow off of the landing platform. that is there to the right of the expat club. A couple of them are standing up on top of the main bodies of the Sentinel shuttles there, and they are sweeping with brooms snow off of the vehicles and off of the landing field. There are three... there's a little hangar building there as well. There are three doors.
Can I do something for us on the way?
Of course.
I'd like to charm him one more time, and I would say something... Rathamith, you know, I gotta take care of some things before we get up there. In the spirit of cooperation, would you mind helping me out? And I would try to get him to help me pay off and get my Lando cloak back.
So, how...
Nice!
Hey, we first met. I need $1,000.
So you're like, it says,
yeah,
a financial man. And he is, you're going to try to charm him? Just a moment, sir.
I mean, if he says something back, I'd say, Rathamith, originally I was going to win it from you.
Well, I'm just looking at what the difficult... I am looking at what the difficulty of your charm check will be, sir. That's all I'm saying.
Jedi are known for waltzing in and doing big asks. Like, Qui-Gon shows up, he's like, hey, I like your kid, I'm going to free him and take him away from you.
No, I know. I just need to find the stat line I'm going to use for Rathamith. That's all.
He can be intimidated.
So it is going to be red, purple. Coerce, or deceive him is that because he is nobody's fool, and he knows when somebody's trying to sweet talk him, you know.
He holds money higher than his own life.
That is the difficulty. Red, purple.
Damn,
against your charm. I understand that you have some talents. There aren't set that work, so there's. There aren't setbacks yet. That was the difficulty without setbacks. So it would be red, purple, one setback from the cold, which you're already removing because you're a Pantoran. And I will say there's another setback because you're not a member of the club.
Yet.
You know,
it's true. It's a social setback.
You know, if you want favors, accept the offer that he's already made to you. So it's red, purple, setback. You can remove the setback. Okay.
And I'd like to use a destiny point as well.
All right, you're going to spend a destiny point?
Yes, I would like to.
Excellent. Being as charming as possible. He says, no, sir. I'm afraid if you want money out of me and the club, you'll have to do it through our formal channels. But, of course, once you're a member, all sorts of benefits open to you.
I can't wait to join.
This works if you can afford the membership fee.
I shuffled myself in the backseat.
Yeah. Once you've paid your dues, man, you can, you know, all of their services are.
I'm sure you can negotiate for your services also and get rid of these remnant.
Well, that's
Jedi as anything.
That was our whole, that was his whole, like, you'll do this, right? You'll get me out of this hole, right?
Yeah, so you...
That gives you leverage.
Man, try to hit him up.
I've been as charming as you possible, or Pantoranly possible. But
he's
pretty
too...
soon Narset's gonna get a hold. He's gonna scare the shit out of them.
Again, yeah, I know. That's fun. We've got two hands, and we're trying to use the easiest hand.
Hey, so, we're just playing blue cop, bad cop.
He does not. Yeah, blue blade, red blade. It's a game we play.
I mean, if I'm chaotically neutral here, like you. You're giving off Lando's jackets, no skin off my back. That's your own shit.
You know, Lando's other coat is what's been keeping you nice and snug and warm in the back
True,
of this open-topped land speeder.
Yeah.
So he declines your ask of a loan as you pass through the center of town. And then you pull up on slide 8, where you see armorless stormtroopers sweeping snow. There's another stormtrooper, this one still in armor, no helmet, red shoulder plate, who is standing off to the side, apparently either supervising or directing these other gentlemen in the sweeping snow. You can not make out what he is barking at them over the sound of the wind as the land speeder pulls by, but the volume still carries quite a way. And then it pulls around the side of the club building, between it and that cluster of smaller buildings. Rathamith eyes them all warily. He says, we managed to lock out most of this rabble, from the suites. They couldn't pass the dress code, so the droids won't allow them up the turbo lift. But their officers have moved in. The rest of them are all here in the outbuilding, which has caused most of the workers, who we did put up in decent accommodations, miss, over his shoulder to Narset, to have to move back to their own lodgings in Fishtown. And of course, with the club out of business, I'm afraid the whole situation is a sticky one. The vehicle pulls around the side and heads down a level into a below-ground parking area. There are three other land speeders in a row that this vehicle pulls up next to, parked in the corner, sort of to the side of them, is what appears to be like a repulsor skiff. So less of a land car and more of the sort of skiff that they were using alongside the sail barge in Return of the Jedi, although this one looks like it's rigged for travel over ice. So this is a repulsor skiff for ice fishing expeditions. It too is done up in sort of a gaudy chromium and gold piping body styling. But it's clear underneath that it is just like an ordinary, like, hut use repulsor skiff. But, you know, it's been done up quite, well enough that anybody on it, you know, it'll feel classy out on the ice with, like, the locals. And then the whole far side of the bay has three Imperial hover transports are lined up. And you can see a couple of stacks of crates with Imperial cogs on them and a couple of armored gentlemen. Their stormtrooper armor is scuffed in ill repair and generally along the likings of far outpost remnant and nobody who's under any, you know, moth worth their salt or stationed on, you know, a capital ship that's still doing Imperial type stuff. But there are a couple of guys with E-11s in armor, you know, leaning against some crates just to keep any of the turtles or the droids away from these transports that they brought over in their sentinels. They perk up when they see the land speeder come in, but they don't look like they're gonna get up from where they're sitting and leaning against these crates, unless somebody who can make them do push-ups comes in, and that's not you guys, so they don't pay you any mind. Rathameth looks terrified, like an opera about the High Republic is going to break out with full choreography at any moment, and attempts to hustle you guys over to the turbo lifts up into the complex as swiftly as he can.
Like, he thinks the Imperials just have, like, a Jedi radar.
And that, yeah, and then you guys will pop lightsabers and you're going to, like, start wire running across, you know, like, their heads, and it's going
to
be like
imprinted in us to just kill troopers on sight. Yeah.
Right. It'll be Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon in here any minute, and he doesn't want any part of that. He's going to try to take you guys all the way up to the club level directly if he can, which is the casino level that the club has retreated to after the remnant took over the main bar area downstairs.
Who's the dude in the red?
That is Kolvar.
Oh.
He is the head at present of the Expatriates Club. The club president.
Are these new droids?
I'm just moving them. There are security droids. Now that they have moved up here from the sidebar, they were down on the main floor over to the side by the turbo lifts last night, but now that they've moved up here and abandoned the first floor, they've made sure that some security droids were retasked up here in case any of the Imperials managed to override the dress code sensors on the turbo lift and come up to the casino level or the actual rooms, which are up from here on higher levels where, like, the actual hotel rooms are and such. Right now, the Imperials can't get up because their jumpsuits and uniform are not... They shouldn't be here anyway, and the hotel systems know that they are not guests, because guests would have better wardrobe than that. So they're not allowed up the turbolift. If they hacked that, at least now there are 5 security droids around, you know, just in case things go south. Kolvar, the cape gentleman that you were playing Kintaro against the night before, is grinning widely as Rathamith leads you out of the turbolift. Says, "My friend, I'm so glad you've returned. I hope you found accommodations in town. Seeing as you didn't join us last night, I know you weren't ready to join the club yet, but we had the droids prepare a room for you in case. We can't let fine folk like yourself left to wander the wastes of this ice ball. That's not how we treat prospective members. Did your day with Mr. Rathamith please you?"
Oh, yeah. Yes. It's very informative. And, you know, our time with him has certainly given us enough time to ponder and accept your offer of joining your club. So, Rathamith did quite well. You should know.
His grin.
In fact, there's something more. Rathamith
doubles in wideness.
Won a bet against us.
He did?
Yeah. He says, won a bet.
Really,
now,
Rathamith?
Now we're here to join.
Really? Rathamith, a bet. You. I know we didn't make our money manager isn't a man who gambled, sir. If he made a bet with you, it was only because he knew he would win. That's why we don't allow him at our gaming court. He comes over and puts an arm around each of your shoulders and turns you to face the others at the bar and says, "Of course, when we were a larger group, this was a more formal proceeding. But seeing as our numbers have dwindled, we're scarcely in a position to be picky. If you turn out to be a brigand, sir, I assure you we will turn you out. But for now, my good people, what say you? Prospective member?" There is a mixed, a half-hearted from the Rodian Pixelplex that you just took to the cleaners last night. The Togruta woman in the corner didn't really speak with either of you, but she looks you over and makes a sign of assent with her hand. Rhodes, the Faelene woman that you were next to at the Hintaro table, lowers her glasses and gives you a predatory look, Zavix, and then signals her assent as well. The human gentleman in the yellow robe shrugs, and Kintera, who is sitting at the bar with a stack of data pads to one side and 3 more overlapping each other in front of her, turns distractedly, then perks up and nods. And Kolvar tightens his grip around your shoulders and says, "Of course, there's a much longer process. Credit check. We'll have to speak to your references, to your character and such, sir, but for the moment, consider yourself welcome to the Expatriates Club as a prospective member. And you as well, miss. I don't believe, other than your brief time at the table with us last night, that I had time to speak with your ward, sir."
Ward?
You're a young woman who's not apparently in a relationship with him, and they're kind of old-fashioned, and assuming that you are not traveling on your own and he is your chaperone of some sort. But he did not, you didn't come forward and introduce yourself, so he's not there as your bodyguard. He's here as the guy, and you're the young woman with him.
Gotcha.
You know? So,
I got
it's
you.
Just...
Got you.
Yeah. You're the Dick Grayson to his
exactly.
Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
And so, Kolvar looks very enthusiastic about this, as he is about any signs of new life being breathed into his organization. After he releases the two of you, Rathamith darts in to whisper something in his ear. The reaction he gives makes it clear that this wasn't their Jedi, because his eyebrows don't shoot up through the ceiling. And it's probably more, "I have to talk to you later, Rathamith." kind of thing. You know, but he shoots his eyes towards Rathmuth and shoos him off towards the bar.
Well, may I say something?
Sure, of course.
To the whole group, to everybody in the room, ladies and gentlemen, in spirit of cooperation, I feel that it has come time for me to come clean about what's going on here and why I'm really here. I'm sure Rathamith is excited to tell you, and I hate to steal that away from him, but I unsheathe my my lightsaber and light it up right in front of him. I tell them, White Knight here. I tell them, don't be afraid. I'm here to help solve your problem. I'm here to help get rid of the Empire in the area, and I hope that we can work together to do that. I'm sorry that I had to take money from you last night, but until now, I had to operate in secrecy.
So, it's just shock. Like,
can I use the charm roll on that one for it as well?
Yeah, absolutely. Go ahead and roll charm.
I just have that monkey meme in my head of just like
it's going to be. So it's going to be two reds, because it's not a hard check. It's only like an average check, but it's two reds because, like, you know, you might roll a despair and one of these guys is like, no, the only thing I was glad about when they stopped having a republic is that they did over those damn Jedi who were screwing up the republic. We wouldn't have had an empire if it wasn't for the Jedi or whatever. But
can I ask?
That's only if the despair comes up.
Is Zavix doing this as a tactic, or is he interpreting the vision as it brought us here so we could get rid of these Imperials? Are you in earnest saying that this is why I'm here?
I mean, he's told these guys that this is why he's here.
Well, right, and I'm just saying, like, is that Zavix's interpretation of the vision? Like, hey, we've been brought here, and there's a bunch of Imperials. Maybe this is, or are you just sort of blowing smoke up their ass to get them on side right now?
I am literally telling the truth to them.
Okay,
I'm telling truth to my new allies. I don't see them as a threat. They're definitely something that can help me achieve my goals, and I feel like I can help them as well.
So you're Ned Starking it. You're just leaving it all out there for him.
So, you three failures.
Oh, dang.
One of which is a despair. And four advantages. So it goes down like a lead balloon. And the security droids.
I'm supposed
in the
to be
room,
the charming one here.
So you have failed to you. Okay. So advantageously, two member. All right, you can. We're gonna have a fight. Guys, after this is what? Hey, combat.
We have 1, 2, 3, 4. So we have 5. We're
gonna.
Robot,
I'm going to parse this for you, and then we are going to cliffhanger it and go to the other guys, and then we're going to come into the fight later in and cliffhanger that, and maybe or maybe not finish this. I don't know how it's going to break down. Okay, so 4 advantages. 4 people. Of the people around the bar are like, all right, yeah, cool. Just like he said, it's our hero. You have brought the Rodian, who was like, fucking this guy took me to the cleaners. Oh, I'm not a bad gambler. He's a Jedi, and he apologized for it. He came around. The Togruta woman, who was indifferent, came around. The human in the yellow came around, and if anything, the archaeologist woman who already, like, the fact that you didn't keep talking to her last night and were just like, you came over, spoke, she didn't roll well, and she was like, let's talk by the bar, but then you, like, talked to some other people and then left and went and bought armor and stuff. And she was waiting for you to keep talking to her last night. That's why she wasn't around today. You know what I mean? So she went to her books to be like, well, if he's here, maybe I, you know, this and that. The Phalene woman looks terribly put out by all of this. You know, like, she was going to make a meal of you, and it's like, I don't eat Jedi. You know what I mean? Like, you're telling me that this was vegan?
Right.
Or you didn't tell me there was meat in this? Is like, you know what I mean? She was like, damn, I thought, like, here's a guy who's winning. She is put out. In the same way that the Rodian was like, oh, okay, cool, I was losing, and I thought he was kicking my ass, but he's a Jedi. And she was like, oh, damn, this guy was actually in it. Like, somebody around the table other than Kolvar who can hang in, you know, like, around the betting table. And it turns out it's because he's a fucking liar, you know, of a Jedi. But all of that is not nearly as important as the fact that despairingly these security droids just saw you pull out a deadly weapon within 2 feet of the president of the Expatriate Club, and 3 of them, because that's how many failures you got, are activated.
The 3 closest to us.
Right, yeah. Now. Oh no, it's table. Not going to be. It's going to be the 2 along that southwest wall and the 1 all the way across the room who's not right next to somebody with a lightsaber. Actually.
That's random as fuck. So not the 1 next to me?
No, because then you can take it out in 1 round and the fight ends too quickly. All right? You make... These are the GM's tactics for making sure that the fight against the player characters lasts long enough to make it worth having had to be.
Can you roll a destiny to make it harder?
Who said that?
Make it harder for who?
He faces. Who the
he wants more fight? Yeah, I'm going to roll a destiny point right now, and if there are dark side pips, they will activate further droids. If there are light side pips, they're not going to not activate
droids. I would imagine the droids are networked to the point where if you damage one, they all come online.
So conceivably, you could get 2 more droids. But you didn't. All right, so you light up your lightsaber. You see looks of, frankly, awe from most of your audience, except for the Phalene gambler, who instead looks like her tasty treat turned out to be a rotten egg. Kolvar, you see in your peripheral, is like, he looks like he just got elected Chancellor of the Republic. He's the president of the Expats Club and a Jedi just joined the Expat Club and said he's here to save them. You know, and he was the president when it happened. He is also writing his acceptance speech. Then you hear,
deadly weapon detected. Key of your weapon, lethal force, has already been authorized.
And 3 of the security bots around the wall take menacing steps forward as both of their forearms come up. On the back of each hand are the barrels of 2 laser blasters.